coming up on today's episode of the Salesman Podcast.
Yeah, sure. I think everyone's made it way too complicated. I hear people saying, oh, I was introverted before, but I'm not introverted anymore. Like it's some burden that they have to get rid of, they had to shed themselves of. And then there's other people that say, I was extroverted, but COVID's kind of made me feel a little bit more introverted. I mean, the truth is that, yes, there are skill sets that become more refined by doing so-called extroverted behaviors, but it really comes down to where you draw your energy from.
Hello, Sales Nation. My name is Will Barrett, and I'm the host of the Salesman Podcast, the world's most downloaded B2B sales show. On today's episode, we have the legend. He's been on the show a bunch of times now. We have the legend, Matthew Pollard. He is the author of the new book, The Introvert's Edge to Networking. And of course, that's exactly what we're getting onto on today's episode. What an introvert is, the superpowers that they have, and how they can leverage them to crush extroverts in the realm of business networking. Everything that we talk about in this episode is available in the show notes over at salesman.org. And with that said, let's jump right into it. Okay, so we're going to dive into introvertedness, networking, generating leads, and a whole lot more. We'll hopefully get into the virtual element of all this and how that potentially mixes things up and changes the dynamic in a second. But just for anyone who hasn't caught any of our previous episodes, just so this can stand alone, can you give us a bit of a definition of what introvertedness is and then how you would classify or define yourself as an introvert or an extrovert?
Yeah, sure. I think everyone's made it way too complicated. I hear people saying, oh, I was introverted before, but I'm not introverted anymore. Like it's some burden that they have to get rid of, they had to shed themselves of. And then there's other people that say, I was extroverted, but COVID's kind of made me feel a little bit more introverted. I mean, the truth is that, yes, there are skill sets that become more refined by doing so-called extroverted behaviors, but it really comes down to where you draw your energy from. So for me, I mean, I can very happily go out networking. I can do podcast interviews like this. I can speak from stage, I can sell, but at the end of it, I'm absolutely physically and mentally exhausted and I need to go and, you know, go and watch Netflix for half an hour and just recharge. So that's why I define myself as an introvert. Now, I have a great friend, Jim Cathcart, who's one of the most award-winning speakers in the world. He was out, you know, speaking on stage at one of my conferences, you know, recently. And at the end of that, you know, he wanted to go out and party and experience the live music capital of the world in Austin because he was an extrovert. It charged him up. So for people, don't overcomplicate it. If you charge up from being by yourself and or with just a couple of family members, you're an introvert. If you charge up from being with people, you're an extrovert. And for me, I have discovered a long time ago that I was an introvert, but I also discovered that that was an advantage and not something I should be ashamed of.
Sure. And for further context, I would say, and you can tell me if this is just complete nonsense, but I would say I'm right down the middle in that pre-COVID and everything that was going on, I'd be seeing people during the day, lots of meetings, these podcasts, all that kind of stuff. And I just want to get home and watch Netflix and just watch Game of Thrones, whatever it is, in the evening and chill out. Now, I'm spending so much time head down doing our content over at salesman.org and some new training content that we're bringing out over the next kind of 12 months that I basically don't speak to anyone during the day. And so when I get home, I just wind my partner up because I've got so much energy and I need to speak and engage with her. So I get energy from being with her because I'm so drained of it during the day from being on my own. So I feel like I flip-flop between the two depending on the environment. But is that reasonable or am I overcomplicating things myself here, Matthew?
Well, the way I'm interpreting that is that because you're by yourself all day, your battery is super charged up and full. Like a lot of people misunderstand introversion. It doesn't mean we want to be by ourselves and isolated forever all the time. Like we still need contact with people. Like, you know, if I was told to sit in a dark room and just write a book all day, like eventually I'd be like, oh my gosh, I need to go and speak to a person. And, you know, I drive my wife nuts with things as well because I'll sit in my office and I'll work all day and then I want to give her a download. But again, your wife is somebody that you trust where you can be yourself as well. So there are two things going on there. One is you may find being with your wife a charging event as well, but also you need contact. You know, a lot of introverts think that they just want to be locked away and never speak to anyone. But then, you know, that is not what they need. They just want to be able to charge up. Extroverts are the exact opposite of that, right? They think they want to be around people all the time. But even eventually, they're going to want to have some downtime for themselves because they, you know, they just need a way of getting rid of that energy. You know, a lot of extroverts will find writing soothing. They just won't sit down and do it all day. They'll want to do it for a couple of hours and then go back out and hang out with people.
Yeah, that makes total sense. Okay, so let's tie with the definitions in place. Let's tie this back to the world of networking. I'm going to give you a massively loaded and leading question here because we're both on the same wavelength with a lot of this stuff, I think, Matthew. So is networking, right, when we say that word, does it mean that we go to a conference, we have some gibber gabber with some random people that we don't really want to be speaking to, we grab some business cards, and then we escape as quick as possible? Is that what networking is?
Oh gosh, I hope not. Because if so, if it was, I wouldn't be doing it, that's for sure. And you know, the way people that perceive it that way probably assume the gibber gabbing is fueled by alcohol as well, yep. Because that makes this a little bit more bearable for everybody, right? But the truth is that that isn't great networking. I mean, the way I see it is there are two types of networkers that I see prevalent in the modern day networking world. And also, we're talking about face-to-face networking now. There's lots of different types of networking, but the people that focus on face-to-face networking tend to be either transactional, which are the people you'll see walk around the room going, do you want to buy from me? No. What about you? What about you? What? I would hate to be that person. So then there's a lot of people, even extroverts, that don't want to be that person. So because of that, they become that aimless networker that doesn't want to pitch themselves. So they'll either sit in the corner and talk to the people that approach them, or they'll talk to people with the goal of not being salesy, but that just makes them aimless. So they'll feel like they've created these kind of shallow relationships with people. And then there's this promise of, oh yeah, we'll reach out, we'll swap cards. But then you get home and you're like, well, I don't even have time to meet up with the friends I already have. Like, I'm not going to contact those people. So the cards just sit there until eventually they get relegated to a closet or a drawer. And eventually, you know, the wife comes in and says, there's too much clutter in your office, or the husband does, and you throw them out, right? That isn't great networking. What I always suggest is that there is a third type, and it's strategic networking, but it's about going in with a plan. Like 90% of networking is successful. 90% of networking success happens before you even walk in the room. I mean, in today's world, if you don't have a way of clearly articulating the value you provide in a way that isn't, oh, I'm a business coach. Oh, I had coaching before. It didn't really work out. Well, that's awkward. Or, oh, I need coaching. How much does it cost? Now we're talking about price, which we know in sales we should never do. Right. If you don't have a way of transforming that, where you're not having someone politely listen to a 2-3 minute conversation where you're trying to explain what you do, right, you're going to fail. If you're in the wrong room, you're going to fail. If you do what a lot of people do and just open up the fire hose of information to everybody that listens to you, you're going to fail. And you got to fix all of that before you even walk in the room. But then you should also strategically pick the rooms you go to, strategically pick the people you speak to. People say, I'm really lucky that I managed to speak to all the right people about all the right things. And I'm like, it takes a lot of effort before I go in to be that lucky. And if you spent that time, you'd be a lot luckier too.
Sure. Okay. So let's, obviously that was a ridiculous example, and I'm sure the audience kind of are on the same thread as here, especially in the world of COVID, that going into a room is not the most useful way you can spend your time as a B2B salesperson, because it's unlikely you're going to do any transactional sales in that environment. So with that said, Matthew, and let's narrow things down here for the audience, and let's assume that we are networking to build relationships that then deals get closed on, as opposed to we're networking to build influence, or we're networking to, I don't know, if we've got political aspirations, or we're trying to get our kid on the football team, whatever it is. So let's stick to the track of we're networking in a professional capacity of getting a deal done at the end of it. So if the goal is to be strategic and we need an aim, is there a series of steps that we need to put into place to go from kind of step A to deal closed, which is step Z?
Yeah, absolutely. So firstly, I mean, networking and sales are two totally different things. Even if the goal is to get a deal at the end, you have to understand that networking is about providing value and allowing the person to experience your passion, your mission, and the people that you mean to help them see the person that you mean to serve. When you transfer to the sales activity, I mean, I also say that sales should be all about giving value and having a dialogue and listening, and then eventually moving into a sales activity by saying, you know, telling a great story and delivering a moral and then saying something like, so at this stage, I can do one of three things. I can direct you to some great free content we created that'll help you, you know, get the outcome yourself. I can direct you to an online academy that we have, or I can talk to you about the process of working with me one-on-one, or if you have a SaaS product or something like that, I can direct you to some great resources you can use for free, or I can talk to you about what we can do for you. That means that they'll say, no, talk to me about what you can do, and now you have permission to sell. At that point, you're then in a sales activity. Until then, you're not. You're in a consultative conversation. Now, networking should never be salesy, even if, and I see people blunder this all the time. Somebody goes, oh, Will, no, what you said sounds amazing. How can I work with you? And I do this with simulations with clients all the time. And the person will always fall for it and go, oh, thanks for asking. And they'll start telling me about all the great things they can do. And then I'll go like this and I'll say, oh, John, great to see you. I haven't seen you in forever. The salesperson just got interrupted, right? Now it's super awkward. Networking is not the place to sell. But if your goal is to find prospects to sell to, you have to remember that you have to set them up the right way. For instance, no one wants to see that transactional person that walks person to person, but also no one wants to speak. Like, let's say for instance, you sold insurance. If you introduce yourself as an insurance salesperson, we know that the person that hears that is, I mean, we all know that the one person you don't want to walk into in a networking room is an insurance salesperson, right? So you're like, oh my gosh, how do I get away from this person? I'm going to have to politely listen for 2 minutes before I can run away. And, you know, actually Nick Jensen was a person like that. You know, he sold insurance and he said he as an introvert, it was terrible for him. He'd go in, he'd say he's an insurance person, and he could see their eyes scream as they were trying to figure out a way to get away from him. And he said, it was just really tough. And he said, well, is there something that I can do to kind of make that not happen when I first introduce myself? I said, yeah, absolutely. But we need to get deeper into why you actually do sell insurance. Because, I mean, let's face it, no one wants to say, hey, you know, I've been dying to meet you because I thought that you were the sale that would really help me get my commission check for the new Bentley I've been trying to buy. It just doesn't work. So we need to get deeper into what you actually care about. And every person selling anything has something that they genuinely care about that drew them to the product or service that they're selling. You know, for Nick, I asked him the question. I said, well, help me understand why you got insurance. And he's just like, well, you know, it was just a great product. I felt like added value. I'm all right. Adds value to people that make 50,000 or 250. Like, which person do you care about most? And his response was, well, you know, I could make more money out of the person that earns 250. So there's better commission there. So probably that demographic. And it's, well, we're not really getting where I want to go here. So what about the person that studied hard in school, got into the right university, got into that C-level executive role, and now, you know, runs a big organization versus the person that hustled to start a small business and created a successful business of their own? Who do you think, you know, you would like to work with more? He said, well, obviously the small business owner. And I'm like, well, why obviously? And he said, well, I just feel like they deserve more help. I'm like, why? They both hustled to get where they are. And then he started telling me about this story of his grandfather that started a farm, and he employed all these people. And then because they didn't have the right insurance, he got sick and he had to sell the farm and moved into an apartment complex. He said he just watched his grandfather die watching TV on the couch for the last 10 years of his life. He said, you know, so I just feel like they deserve more help. And I said, but hang on a second, you know, you sell life insurance policies. I mean, this, how would that have helped the grandfather? And he said, well, you know, there's these policies where you can put money into them and then you can rotate that into high interest that you can then leverage into these amazing property investments. And I said, well, how would it feel if instead of calling yourself an insurance salesperson, we called you the hustle lifeguard and you worked only with small business owners to help the hustlers of this world not get so busy that they forget to prioritize their own retirement? And then you told these amazing stories around the people that you helped. So networking became, instead of I'm insurance, how do I get away from you, to, oh, I'm the hustle lifeguard. Oh, what exactly is that? Oh, well, you know, I'm really passionate about this, so I'm on a mission to do this. Actually, let me give you an example. Does that make sense? And then all of a sudden, you've got someone on the hook. The balance is from, oh my gosh, I don't want this. Instead, oh, I'm interested. Oh, that's a really great cause. Yeah, I am really interested. And if you've done your research, you're an event full of small business owners. And the people that you're speaking to, you've already kind of connected with maybe on LinkedIn even before you went in. Now, if you're virtual, then the great thing is these days, if you introduce yourself as the hustle lifeguard and you talk about your passion for helping the small business owners not get lost in their own retirements, that's very different to saying, I'm an insurance salesperson and I just want to make sure your insurance needs are catered for, right? It's a completely different outcome. And it allows you to be a much more authority when you're talking about posting content online and actually interacting and not being perceived as a salesperson. We see sales representative, sales consultant, insurance salesperson, and we want to run for the hills. You don't want to be calling yourself any of those words that say, my next statement is going to be, let's book a 15-minute call so I can sell you something.
Okay, right. So we're definitely going to get into personal branding, thought leadership, how much of networking we can do ahead of time, whether we can scale this with content and things of that nature in a second. But there's one thing, there's going to be a lot of people now listening to this, tens of thousands, Matthew, who are scratching their head and going, okay, how do I do what Matthew's just outlined for, was it Nick, the person you were engaging with? The answer is part one, get the book, and part two, probably work with yourself. But is there any questions to shortcut this process so people can put this into practice today before the book arrives? Is there any questions we should be asking ourselves to uncover a link between our passion and the product or the organization or the industry that we work in?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it actually is a lot simpler than you think. And yeah, I mean, absolutely, you can get the answer in my book, but you know, I don't like people to have to buy my stuff to be able to get to these outcomes. So I can give you a quick download of the questions, but what I would always suggest is after you've listened to this and, you know, if you're enjoying this podcast, go find somebody else that hasn't listened to this podcast, get them to listen to this section of the episode, and then do this exercise with someone else that is not from your industry. And the reason being is if you sell insurance and you meet with another person that sells insurance, you're going to get caught in each other's industry jargon. So what I want you to do is that if you go to MatthewPollard.com/growth, you'll be able to download this template with the questions that I'm highlighting now. But what you really want to do is you want to first look at all the customers that really sing your praises. And you want to write down all the names of those people. And I'm talking, these are the people that, you know, when they go to a networking room and somebody says, I'm really looking for cloud technology. And they're like, oh, you've got to talk to this person. They're just amazing. Now, those are the people's names you really want to write down. Now, then what you want to do is you want to go over to another list and you want to write down all the people you make amazing money from. For instance, if that person calls, you just kind of hear that cha-ching in your head and you're like, all right, I'm going to get, you know, this is going to be my money-making list. So now you've got these two lists. You've got the people that sing your praises and you've got the people that you make great money out of. What you want to do is you want to start to look at what the similarities are between these lists. So what I want you to do is start to group these people around the things that perhaps make them similar. It might be that they all, you know, support the same football team and, you know, you're a mad supporter of that team. Maybe that's the connection. It might be like for Nick that, you know, they tend to be a lot of small business owners that feel really connected to him. It might be for me, the average introvert that feels more connected with me because I'm an introvert that learned to sell and learned to network. But what you want to do is you want to start to group these things about whatever similarities that you see. Now you're going to have a bunch of different groups. What I then want you to do is pull out a red pen and a blue pen. Now, these color pens don't work any different than the other ones. It's just that's what most people have on their desk. And I want you to circle in red all the ones you make amazing money out of, all the groups that you make amazing money out of. And then I want you to circle in blue all the groups that, you know, sing your praises, which means you probably really love working with them. And what you'll notice now is there's a whole set of groups that only have red circles. And there's a whole set of groups that only have blue circles. But there's these magical few that have both circles around them, both blue and red. These are the ones that you make great money out of and sing your praises. So it's the places you're going to make the most money, but also you're actually going to enjoy working with these demographics. Now, a lot of people may just have one. You know, I did this with 200 people at a conference recently before the whole COVID lockdown, and literally everybody had at least one that had both circles around it. But some people will have multiples. Now, I guarantee you really can create a rapid growth business or a rapid growth sales career in anything. But there's nothing worse than a rapid growth business with customers you can't stand and a business you don't like. And I promise you that you'll always sell more to people that are aligned with your passion and your mission. So some of these demographics may not be as aligned, and some of them may be groups that you'd enjoy selling, but not as much as one other type. So now if you're struggling to really make a choice and you have to pick just one, if you're struggling to make a choice, I would suggest that you spend some time really aligning yourself with what you're truly passionate about. And I have a podcast called The Better Business Coach. You can go to episode 17, which is called Forget About Goals, Why is the Key to Success? Do that exercise, and then what will happen is you'll become a lot more laser focused and the decision will become obvious to you. Once you pick that group, you then say, well, what are the things that I do above and beyond my functional skill for that group? What are the key unique passions that I have, the unique experiences that I have that allowed me to serve that group? And then finally, you say, what's the higher level benefit of that? Which, you know, for Nick was, you know, he became, you know, the hustle lifeguard. For me, if you think, you know, I'm a branding expert, a marketing specialist, a social media strategist, I mean, I'm too many things. Nobody cares. Yep. But if I grab all of those things together and say, what's the higher level benefit of that? Well, that's helping introverted business owners obtain rapid growth, right? So what you, that is the five-step exercise at its simple terms. But what I would suggest is if you download it at matthewpollard.com/growth, you know, I did this with 200 people, and at the end, I said, you know, put your hand up if you now have a unified message that you know will excite and inspire people to want to know more, but you've also identified your niche of willing to buy clients. Like 97% of the room put their hands up, which sounds awesome until I said, keep your hands up if this is the most time you spent on marketing since you started your business or your sales career. Like 85% of the room kept their hands up. The whole session was 45 minutes. So for people, if they just spend an hour with someone outside their industry, spend an hour on you, an hour on them, so 2 hours in total, I mean, you'll do this on your own. You don't need someone like me to help you do that. Now, sure, it might be helpful to get some feedback or help someone cut the learning curve, but a lot of people will be able to do this absolutely by themselves.
Perfect. Love it. Okay, so it seems like then, if you are introverted and you listen to this show, it seems like, tell me if I'm wrong, you can do a lot of, and I guess we can try and objectify this on a sliding scale in a second. We can do a lot of work before we walk into the room to make, to lubricate the conversation, to make everything go simpler and easier, versus an extrovert who might be happy to go in and it might not be as effective, but try and blag their way through these conversations. And they might have the gift of the gab and the ability to do that. But for an introvert, it seems like if we can define who we serve, who we can add value to, if we can brand ourselves like Nick did in your example there, and just by having who you serve and how you can serve them, the branding comes together very nicely there, right? Is there another element to this where we need to create or we can potentially create content or storytell or do something along those lines so that perhaps we connect on LinkedIn with people before an event, whether it's virtual or in person, so that, again, everything is just lubricated so that the conversation flows much more easy and there's less stress and anxiety about the whole situation when we actually speak with the individual?
Yeah. So, I mean, absolutely. So the question you asked is, can I do more preparation? And absolutely, introverts should prepare everything before they go. So for me, you know, when I go to a networking event, I will connect with people beforehand, you know, just even just connecting, saying, you know, I'm excited about seeing you at this event. Or, hey, this, when I first came to Austin, I would write something like, oh, I saw that you went to so-and-so event last time. I'm going this month because, you know, I'm new to the city. You know, I'd just love to know if you think that the event was any good. That will start the dialogue. And if you have your hustle lifeguard or rapid growth guy, you know, attached to your profile, people are going to go, well, that's interesting. And they'll then read in to find out more about you. So absolutely, there's a ton you can do. But if you think about, you know, what level of preparation we can do, we have such an advantage over the extroverts, because an extrovert will just wing it. So of course, you know, they love the whole concept of the numbers game. So I'll just see more people, and it doesn't matter if I see more people. But if their statistical average is, you know, 20 sales every 100 contacts, that's the way it's always going to be. An introvert, we perfect the process. So we set it and we get better and better. So yeah, sure, we suck at the beginning, but we get miles better. And eventually, you know, a system will always remove more defects over time. So we'll end up completely, you know, outselling them. I mean, I go to business meetings with people that, you know, we'll have just like a first meeting. And the extrovert is just happy to be having that conversation. And they're happy to for the conversation to go wherever it goes. And for me, I'm in this regimented way. To them, it feels organic. but in my regimented way, I'm leading them through the steps to get to the exact outcome I want. And they're ecstatic at the end because it got to an outcome, and many conversations don't. For me, it always gets to the exact right outcome. So for introverts going in, you want to know, you want to really think about what your passion and mission is so you can align that. You know, a lot of people say, follow your dreams, follow your passion. Well, that doesn't make sense if you can't make money out of it. So you have to align passion and mission with business and what you do. And everyone got into what they do for a reason. You could have done anything at the start. Now, once you've done that, yes, you create this unified message, you then discover your niche, but then you do need great stories, because the problem is at networking events, you finally get someone talking and they're like, oh, that sounds really interesting, tell me more. And then introverts especially, we open this fire hose of information and the customers are, oh my gosh, that's way too much. I'm now overwhelmed. Let me go and buy off some extrovert that simplifies it for me and makes it seem simple. So as an introvert, what we need to realize is there are some real advantages to doing preparation. But if we have a niche, all of a sudden it becomes simple. You know, I do some work for some really big tech organizations who have people straight out of college that come and start their careers, and they've got to learn all this technology. So they're overwhelmed with the amount of technology that they have to know. And then they're sitting down with a customer that's like, mate, you're 12 years old. There's no way you're going to be able to explain all this technology to me. And they're right. But what happens is that if you induct a salesperson and you say, here is the sales play, i.e. here's the niche that I want you to focus on, and here are the three stories in your playbook. These are the three major problems that your niche has. These are the three stories that I want you to learn. Now, all they've got to do is learn those three stories. And when they're sitting in a sales meeting, the customer will say something, give them an objection or ask them about how they can do it. And they're like, actually, this reminds me a lot of this customer. They'll tell the story and it comes across like they've got 30 years of experience. And it doesn't need to be their story. It's the benefit of why we work with these big companies. Instead of saying, I work with this person, you can say, we worked with this person. And people will still assume that you're involved, but you didn't say that. Now, when you're doing this in a networking room, what will happen is you'll say your unified message. Like I'll say, I'm the rapid growth guy. And it's like their brain will short circuit, because it's like, we like to put everything in these nice, neat boxes. Digitally, if I said, hey, I'm a sales trainer, people are, oh, I had sales training. No, thank you. Oh, I'm the rapid growth guy. It's so great. What is that? I have to explore. So the bio can talk about my, the about in my LinkedIn can talk about my passion and my mission. And then when I get onto the physical dialogue with a person, we start and I'll say, you know, it's so great to, you know, connect with you today. You know, I checked out your LinkedIn profile. It looks like you're doing some amazing things, but I'd love to know a little bit more about kind of where you're at now and what your objectives are over the next 12 months or something that gets a dialogue going. And then all you've got to do is say, oh, that's really interesting. Actually remind me a lot of John or Trevor. And then you tell this story. Now, the great thing is stories don't come across as salesy, which is a huge benefit, but people remember up to 22 times more information when embedded into a story. So when you open up your fire hose, firstly, you can't fit as much fire hose information into the story because it's got to be relevant, but it becomes tangible and more memorable for people. Secondly, it short circuits the logical mind and you speak directly to the emotional mind. So when you do this, all of a sudden, instead of people going, I've been on this Zoom call for 4 minutes, what am I even doing here? I'm being pitched. They're like, oh, story time. And they just listen. And you'll get, instead of 8 seconds, you'll get two and a half minutes a story time with the customer, which gives you an amazing advantage to bring them over to your side. But more importantly, especially for introverts, stories are scientifically proven to activate, when you tell them, the reticular activating system of your brain, which basically means, well, if I was to tell you a story, you know, our brains would synchronize and it creates artificial rapport, which we can build into longer rapport. Now, especially in this digital environment, that's actually more important for both introverts and extroverts, because extroverts used to be able to build rapport by just being in the room and being blasé and being dynamic. But on video calls these days, people want to be, we've got 30 minutes. What are we here for? What's the agenda? Let's be regimented. So if you don't have a way to create artificial rapport that you can turn into real rapport, well, you're going to have real problems. Now, introverts, they can use story now to start that conversation. But when they get to the end, introverts are amazing at building deeper relationships. And that's why, again, we have a strategic advantage in and outside the networking room.
Why? I want to come on to virtual versus in-person in a second, but why do introverts have this ability to build deep rapport?
Well, I mean, the first thing, and again, I believe that nobody is unable to learn any skill. I believe there is a system and a process out there we can all obtain amazing success. If we were to look at, you know, networking sales and building deeper relationships, though, it's because introverts, once we get rid of and systemize out our disadvantages of having that initial dialogue, introverts are great listeners. I mean, we listen really well. We ask thought out questions because we listen really well. And we're actually genuinely interested in the answers. Also, we don't want to be the center of attention. So because of that, we're happy to let that other person talk. You know, I was on Jeb Blunt's podcast recently, and actually he actually wrote the foreword for my new book, The Introvert's Edge to Networking. And he talks about the fact that he was on a sale, because by the way, Jeb Blunt, Zig Ziglar, both introverts, by the way. Ivan Meisner, the founder of BNI, the world's largest networking group, also an introvert. But he was talking about how the fact that he got on the sale on a phone call with a client, and he said, well, I just wanted to get an idea of your price. And Jeb just asked a few questions. Next thing, 10 minutes had gone by, and the guy hadn't stopped talking. And at the end, he said, so this is how much our budget is. How much can you do for that? Just because Jeb listened, he was able to close the deal because the person felt heard. So introverts have the ability to ask great questions, genuinely listen to the answers, and then provide valuable feedback. The problem is, because we get so stuck in our head, a lot of times we struggle and we're limited on how we can communicate afterwards, which disadvantages us. So if we have a system that allows us to get out of our head, the ability to listen and the ability to be genuinely interested is a huge, huge advantage. Our empathy is also hugely strong. We empathize with what people say. We can feel their plight, we can feel their pain, and that's powerful. And also, because we practice these stories, they become a lot better over time. So instead of it just this off-the-cuff story of this, oh, I worked with this customer, we gave it to them, it's more like the story of how you met your partner. You know, it becomes eventually this theatrical masterpiece where you know exactly what to say to get the customer so, so excited. Now, an extrovert on the other side is limited by that, because empathy and active listening are skills that they don't generally have as a, you know, a natural ability. The difference is, though, and this is why I'm so passionate about helping introverts, is that an extrovert, either the HR organization will say, you don't listen well, we're going to send you to an active listening course so you can become, you don't empathize, let me send you to a course to learn how to empathize. Or an extrovert will say, I've realized this in myself, and therefore I'm going to go out and learn. An introvert, we just believe there's a barrier. Oh, we have the gift of gab barrier. I just don't empathize well. I can't do this. And it's not true. It's just this self-imposed barrier. And that's why I focus on helping those. Now, on a level playing field, introverts and extroverts will probably do about the same. But what I've learned is that introverts, once they learn the system, they'll hold on to it for dear life, where extroverts, they love to go on back to winging it, which is why more often than not, I believe introverts will outsell extroverts.
Yeah, I don't have all that much experience with sales training large teams, but the contracts that we're doing now and the things that we've got in place and the consulting that we're doing, I found that split. It's really fascinating that you bring it up as well. A extrovert, we give them our sales code assessment so they can pull this data from that. But an extrovert typically want to reinvent things. They're doing well and they want to keep experimenting and changing, whereas the introverts will just tend to stick with our system and become, externally more extroverted over time from an apparent standpoint. And they will stick with the system and they will refine the system as opposed to reinventing things. So it's interesting you bring that up, Matthew, because that is, we've got probably from data from about 250 people now that pretty clearly shows that that's happening.
Well, it's interesting. I mean, extroverts love to wing it. I mean, that's their, I mean, and don't get me wrong. I mean, this isn't new stuff. I mean, Brian Tracy said, you know, the top 10% of all sales performers have a planned presentation, and introverts hold on to planned presentations. So of course, they're the ones that rise to the top. Now, the bottom 80% of people just say whatever comes out of their mouth. Unfortunately, the bottom of that group is going to be introverts, because they're saying whatever that comes out of their mouth, and it isn't so great what's coming out of their mouth. And there's the people that rise to the top are the people that are more extroverted, because it's not so bad, it's just not perfect. So, you know, a lot of times people think, oh, well, it's just the extroverts that succeed. No, it's the people with planned presentations that succeed. And, you know, we both have our burdens to bear. Extroverts don't want to hold on to it, and introverts don't believe that it's out there. And that's why I spend so much of my time, you know, doing interviews like this to help them. You know, I like to see my books as gateway books where people go, okay, I can do this and there is a system. Now, one of the things I do tell people is, you know, sales, networking, you know, it's not like martial arts, right? What you want to do is not try and learn multiple systems. You're going to confuse yourself. Stick to one system and get the basics down, and then become great at that one system and then start to piece in all of the other things that you think can improve it, but only test one thing at a time. Because if you do multiple things, just like a science experiment, you don't know what's blowing up in your face. So, but it's so vitally important to understand that we can. One thing I have seen with introverts specifically, though, is once they realize there's a system for sales, they then go, oh, there must be a system for networking. There must be a system for, you know, interviewing. Like the Introverts Edge to Networking also talks about how people have managed to, you know, obtain six-figure pay rises just by, you know, using a unified message in their interviews and telling great stories and getting jobs well above the one that they're applying for. And what we've noticed is introverts that realize that it's a sales and networking as a system have been able to automatically in interviews be able to leverage those same steps inside a different paradigm and get success as well.
Sure. Okay, so final question for me, Matthew, and this could be a show on its own right. I'm sure we could riff on this for the next hour and a half if we chose to. But how does all this change when we're not going to, at least in the UK, we're not going to big networking events or big conferences? There's just no conferences going on in the UK at the moment. There's very little opportunity to meet people face-to-face, even if it is for a business meeting. I found that a lot of our customers would rather me just Zoom them as opposed to pop into their offices for consulting and things like that as well. So how does this change when we are networking? And perhaps we'll put in the context of we've got somewhat of a relationship, but we're trying to build that relationship to upsell the customer or whatever it is. How does that change for introverts when they are doing it online versus the ability to do it in person?
Absolutely. Well, firstly, I mean, there are some tools that are amazing for doing it online now. I mean, firstly, we've all seen that, well, if you haven't seen this, LinkedIn has now got this memo function where you can do a 60-second voice memo. So everyone wants to type. And, you know, I understand the want to type things as an introvert, but I have, you know, a script that I'll write out and I'll record something constantly and just do a single message that goes out. People these days crave connectivity, right? And they also don't want to get on a call with someone that's boring. So, and they're worried that it's going to be that sales pitch where they're like, oh, tell me a little bit about your business. Well, why didn't you look at my website beforehand? You would have known that on my LinkedIn profile. So if you're a little bit more organic and you will get on a LinkedIn profile and do a, you know, a voice memo that talks about your passion and mission or introduces a story. You know, I was looking at your profile and I actually just finished working with someone very similar to you and, you know, give them a quick 45-second synopsis of what they did, which got me thinking we might be able to help you, you know, which was why I'd love to, you know, schedule a call. Or I'd love to talk to you further and find out a little bit more about where you're at. That will give you an advantage because they'll get a taste of your passion and the story link will get them to actually listen to it. Also these days, I mean, no one's doing voice memos. So it gives you an advantage because people just try it right now because it's something new. Also, there are a ton. I mean, there's an online program now called Lunch Club, which sets up 1-hour conversations with you, with people, and it match makes you. So you're kind of doing like a networking roulette with people, which gives you the ability to meet people all the time. A lot of conferences, like Gerhard Geschwartner from Selling Power magazine, you know, he runs a virtual conference. And at the back end, there's this like networking roulette where you have the opportunity to meet with a whole bunch of people. I know the people at the AISP are doing a very similar thing with their virtual events. The problem is what I'm seeing is people go to the virtual events and they just participate in the conference, not the networking, because it's something that's different. There are so many places to connect with people and everyone's becoming a lot more technologically enabled. And I guarantee if you're introverted, you don't want the world to flip back because this is perfect for us. We get to sit at home or sit at our offices and do nothing more than communicate via virtual interactions. It's amazing, but the problem is we're trying to fit a square peg in a round pot in a round hole, right? You've got to change the way that you're doing things. Today, no one wants to meet with someone if they think that they know what it is, which is why you've got to differentiate. People don't want to meet with someone that's going to give them a direct sales pitch, which is why you need to speak more about your passion and mission and your story to separate yourself from everyone else. But also, everybody's doing straight pitches on LinkedIn. It's driving people nuts. So what you've got to use are different tools. LinkedIn Memo. Facebook also has Memo. People even, you know, started to call me on Facebook Messenger, which I think is great because I'm like, oh, what's that? And then I answer it just to find out. You've got to use different ways to get in, but then it's not about you. It's about them. It's your mission to serve them. It's your stories. That's what's going to separate you. But then also, so many times all these high level organizations are posting content and, you know, the executive, middle management, even the VPs of certain organizations, no one comments on their stuff. So engage and be thought out and thoughtful, and then send them a direct message about their content to start a dialogue. Be interested, not interesting, and then share your passion for why you care about them. Again, if you make the niche choice, it's going to be so much easier, because it's hard to fake interest in technology and medical and, you know, fertilizer. But if you really have a niche, and it doesn't just need to be an industry niche, there are many, many types of niches, then it makes it much easier for you to connect and be relevant to them, because you're only working with people just like them that need what they need.
Yeah, and you said something then, which I think it could be really valuable for the audience, amongst other things, that perhaps attend some of these sales conferences, do the networking and practice, because you're not practicing probably on your customers, but you're practicing with individuals who hopefully they're on your side. They want you to succeed. So if you're a little bit nervous about all of this, or if this is new for you, there's tons of sales conferences. I'll link some in the show notes of this episode as well over at salesman.org that, yeah, go to the conference, do the networking after the fact virtually, and just practice. See if you can get your story out and people engaged and people interested. Because if you can do it to a salesperson, you're going to have a great opportunity with your customer, right?
Well, it's funny. I mean, I used to go out cold call. Like, people that used to get leads in some of my last businesses, they were always like, oh, the leads aren't as good as they used to be. I'm like, mate, I used to walk down the street. Like, I used to cold call. Like, you've got to understand that, you know, any opportunity to practice at the moment is amazing. I mean, for me, you know, when I first start any business, I'll cold call just to get my script down. And then when you start to get inbound leads, it's like, oh, that one's not quite qualified. I'm like, great, this is an opportunity to practice. I'm not going to cancel the call. So it doesn't matter who you get on a networking conversation with. I mean, it definitely beats, you know, practicing in front of the mirror or practicing to your partner who's tired of hearing your networking script. So absolutely, just get on. It doesn't matter who you speak to, practice. And if they feel your passion and mission, and this is interesting, so many times people, I mean, we live in this kind of world where it's kind of nobody, everyone's just going through the motions of doing what their job is. When they truly meet someone that's passionate about what they do, it's like those Rolodexes open. So anyone that you even think isn't in your niche, share what you're passionate about, share what mission you're on, share some of your stories and why you love doing what you do. And you'll find that while they've never introduced anyone else before, they'll be like, you know what? You need to speak to this person and this person. I'll introduce you. So it's always worth your time. And these days, it's not like you're driving an hour to them and an hour back. It's a 30-minute, a 15-minute Zoom call, and you can be on to the next one.
Got it. And it seems like there's a feedback loop here, right, of you do a successful networking conversation, you feel good about it, they introduce you to someone else, you do a better one, which then makes you feel better about it, and you can go on and on with the feedback. So it seems like it's almost a self-fulfilling prophecy, and the process, as you keep banging in, which is super important, the process for introverts gets stronger over that period. So with that, Matthew, we've covered a lot of ground here, mate, and so I'm going to stop us there, because I feel like we could probably go on for another half hour, an hour, diving into this in more detail. Tell us where we can find out more about the book and more about you as well.
Well, absolutely. So, I mean, obviously you can go to theintrovertsedge.com/networking to get the first chapter of my new book. It actually comes out next week. So if you pre-order now and you do pick up a copy, make sure you find me on LinkedIn and DM me your receipt, and I'll make sure you get all the pre-order bonuses and things like that. So definitely download the first chapter of that. And I think that's probably a great place to start. Also, if you haven't read my first book, The Introverts Edge, which focuses on sales, go to theintrovertsedge.com and you can download the first chapter of that there as well. But type Matthew Pollard in Google, you'll find me everywhere. And, you know, really take advantage of all the great free content I put out. I have the Introverts Edge podcast. You know, I put a ton of free videos out on social media, have a YouTube channel as well. So, you know, take the opportunity, if you're an introvert, to start the process of mastering the system of sales and the system of networking.
Amazing stuff. I will link to all of that in the show notes of this episode over at salesman.org. And with that, Matthew, I want to thank you for your time, your insights on all of this. And just as a side note, your passion. It really comes across that you clearly are passionate about people who are business owners, salespeople who are introverted, who you feel maybe, I get the feeling that you feel, they feel that they're at a disadvantage, and it's a valuable service that you give to get them at least on a level playing field with those pesky extroverts.
I appreciate that, mate. And I appreciate you giving me the opportunity to share with all the introverts in your audience. I know there's a ton of them, and I'm sure they're loving the content you provide to help them learn those systems too.